welcome to the latest road trip edition of the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're back in the car. Say hello, Kelly.
Hello, Kelly.
That's what I think that's what we did last time for Station Hotel.
Probably.
Yeah. We are on the road to Regal Rumble in Aberdeen, the Curl. And I'm doing a good job getting my finger in the screen there. We're overtaken. We're in the car. We're still not on the train. We still haven't done trains. We don't do trains.
No.
We're going to see a train tomorrow. Anyway. We're on our way to Curl Aberdeen to see WrestleZone Regal Rumble. We love a Rumble. Rumbles are the best. So I'm so excited for this. I wear my Aspen Faith t-shirt. I'm looking fetching in some tie-dye pink and white for those that are not watching this and they're on the audio version. I've trimmed myself as well and I look all good.
His beard, people. He's trimmed his beard.
That's because I still haven't got my Manscaped kit, that's why. There hasn't been any Manscaped ads for the last few weeks and I still haven't got my kit. From shocking behaviour. But I will obviously plug them religiously once I actually get the kit.
Because you actually get the items.
I'll say they're the best things ever.
How can you plug it without the items?
Exactly. I can't do anything. I need to. It's a forest down there. It's an absolute forest down there. Anyway, so yeah, we're on the road. We've got loads of matches.
This is what the people want to know.
Yeah, they do. This is what people come for this podcast.
Is it really?
It's for the raw stupidity that I come out with, and then I don't edit out. I just do it. I like this. I'll just. You know what? That Michael Scott thing. I can't remember what the quote is exactly, but it's like sometimes I don't know the end of the sentence. I just start the sentence and then just see what happens. That's kind of how I roll with this podcast. Anyway, got 5 matches on the show. I'm trying to open your phone so I can get them back up in front of me, because I've got questions as well. So. You were at a Station Hotel, so this is a weird thing. I don't start off with, it's been a while since you've been to the wrestling. It's been January, so it was, not even 2 months since you were last at the wrestling. So, same as myself. We're on the road to Aberdeen Anarchy, which will be in May. I'm so excited, because it's Rumble season.
It's a hell of a long journey if we're on the road to Aberdeen Anarchy.
Anywho, so... So yeah, we're going to stop and get some food. I don't think I'll do a recording bit there because that's weird. We'll just do some questions here, unless something exciting happens. We're in dice. 5 matches, I think there's 5-6 matches on the show. We'll start with the pre-show and get your raw thoughts on them.
Raw thoughts.
Okay. So we've got the pre-show match. Of course, for those that paid the extra £3 to get into the pre-show section so they can get their seats and so they don't get interrupted by the 2 people that actually buy general admission tickets. It's Conor Malloy against Murphy of the outfit. So big guy, big heavy guy. That looks like my old car.
Billy.
Anyway, sorry. It's Conor Malloy versus Murphy.
You see what I have to deal with?
Big Murphy against Flippy Conor. So it's a nice combination. Because, you know, big dudes throw the boot, little guys, it's good fun.
Yeah.
And we might get a little bit of a preview for the Rumble later on, if Conor can get Murphy over the top rope, you know.
Yeah,
they're
not going to reveal that in the preview match.
Well, you never know, could be some tactics going on. Could Conor do some practice getting, because there's huge guys in this Rumble this year. It's quite a beefy Rumble.
It's a beefy Rumble.
That's gonna be a really good, just a nice pre-show match. I mean, Conor had a great match at Station Hotel against Caleb. It was ace.
It was a good match.
And
he held his own against Caleb as well. And as most of you know, I'm a Caleb diehard. So he held his own. He was really good against Caleb.
Considering it was last minute, because it was supposed to be Caleb Allen. Toot. And it didn't happen. Conor was taken out of the pre-show of the Station Hotel to go into this match. It was fantastic. So I'm looking forward to see what he does with Murphy, because Murphy
watching Conor develop, actually, you know, because we've seen him from the beginning, and with each match he just gets better and better, you know. And
absolutely,
it's quite nice to see that from the beginning.
Well, the last 2019 Rumble was his, like, he had his coming out party, so to speak, because he eliminated Crusher Crabe, and that was like the big, well, it wasn't the biggest moment, unfortunately, because Caleb usurped that by killing Lord Mr. Malice in the same match. But
that Duke was hitting the floor, still rings in my ears.
That's, it's weird though, because I've got a GIF of it, I put it up, and you can still see the camera shake when Malice hits the ground. It's amazing.
The people in the restaurant at the Northern Hotel must have thought that the floor was going to fall in.
it was incredible.
So good.
So good. So yeah, that was the pre-show. The rest of the matches, I'm going to try and do off memory before we go to the questions itself. So first up, we'll go for Ronan King against Damien. So this was set up at Station Hotel as well.
Yeah,
aye. With Ronan taking over that show, because he was in the pre-show, he was in the tag title match, and then he came out and kicked Damien and his injuries.
His fingers
hamstring.
Were in all the pies.
So Ronan King, Damien, I said about it in preview that I don't think this is going to be the end of it.
No.
I think this will be the start of something. There we go, High School Musical fans like myself.
I've had a lot of caffeine today.
Oh, that's because we're on the Prime.
Not sponsored.
We're on, not one, but
two.
We're giddy. We only had like three sips.
We've got a break from the child.
We're giddy. We're excited. We're on Prime. KSI, Logan Paul, pay us. We will take very little, to be honest, in comparison. So, what was I saying? Ronan versus Damien. So again, I don't think this will be the end of anything in particular, but I think it'll be a nice starting point, because Ronan, I say it every time, it pains me to say it.
He's so good.
He's 19.
I know. He's just a baby.
It's disgusting.
But he's fab. He really is, and it pains me to say it, but I hope he wins the match.
Oh, there we go.
Because the last time I saw Ronan, he slagged off my baby.
He did.
It really pains me to say it, but I kind of hope he wins this match against Damien. Because I think Damien's had enough wins now. He needs to, like, I think he needs knocked down a peg or two.
Oh, there we go. Controversial takes there. Controversial takes from Kelly. I think Ronan will win. I don't think he'll do it clean.
No, I think he'll cheat.
And I think that's what we'll get a rematch.
That's
where
we'll get another match at
Abri Anarchy. Yeah. I think that's probably the way it's going to go. But you know, I'm terrible at predicting things the rest of the zone, so you know, who knows. So that should be a lot of fun. We've got the tag title match. We've got the Fair City Saints defending. It's Alex Webb and Aaron Miles defending against the Foundation in the Future. Bruiser Brad Evans and
Bradley.
Brad Evans,
and Ryan Riley.
There you go, redemption.
I do remember your name, Ryan, I promise.
The redemption arc here.
I'm multitasking. I'm being a proper woman here. I'm driving and I'm like trying to remember wrestlers' names. So I apologise for last time. But Ryan Riley.
But these guys had a really great match at Christmas Chaos, which you weren't there for. But they had a really great match there for the titles. That's when Fair City Saints won. And then they've had a couple matches elsewhere in like Perth for Fair City Wrestling.
Remind me again who the Fair City Saints are.
That's Alex Webb, the guy from YouTube.
Oh yeah.
The guy who I put the TikTok about where I mocked his receding hairline, which is an absolute cheek.
I'm just jealous he's still got a hairline.
But it is hanging on for dear life. And Air Miles as well, who Alex likes to call his dad, even though they're about the same age. But anyway, so yeah, I've got a couple of awards to hand them tonight, so that'll be exciting.
That'll be good.
Right,
their match was really good at the Station Hotel.
With Murphy and Ronan.
Yeah, it was really good. So I couldn't predict that one, I don't think.
Yeah, that is one of those weird ones.
To predict that one.
For me, when it comes to predictions, I think the Fair City Saints will win, because I think the Outfit are going to face them at Anarchy. But I don't know what the Foundation are going to do afterwards for Anarchy, unless it's like a triple threat or a four-way or something, or you know. That's a difficult one to predict. Well, yeah, that's fair. I'm not sure. That's fair to say. So yeah, they've got that.
Terrible.
You know me. Chris Archer and Mickey Vago. got
I want Vigo to get redemption, but I don't think he's going to get it.
See, that's the weirdest thing. I think this match and the Rodin Damien match were the two that I thought were going to be anarchy.
The real question about the Archer Vigo match is, will Jonathan ever recover?
Oh, poor Jonathan.
Poor Jonathan.
I mean,
Station Hotel. Oh my god, I just thought, Archer, you broke his heart.
Oh, I saw the footage of Ellen, though. That was amazing. When Archer came out, Jonathan was nowhere to be seen. But when Vigo came out, Jonathan had his bandana on, he had his hand out ready for the high five for the fist bump. It was like, he's picked a side.
Yeah.
He's Archer no more. No more. That's it. No. He's all in on Vigo.
Archer's burnt his bridge.
Absolutely disgraceful. The kind of build up for this is
to be fair though to Archer, Vago's kind of left him behind a little bit. So I can see where he's coming from, but I just don't think he deserved his pal turning on him like that.
So the build up of this is like Vago's saying he's not coming to wrestle Archer, he's coming to talk to Archer, and by the end of it, there'll be a rejected reunion.
Right? But we all know that there's going to be a wrestle. Let's come on, be honest. We all know there's going to be a fight, because that's just how these shows work.
But that's where the intrigue lies, because there used to be a third member of the rejected. It was Kaden Garrick.
Okay.
He didn't wear shorts. It really annoyed me. He wore wear jeans that I'm wearing now, kind of thing.
I don't know if I've ever seen him.
He used to tag with Mr. P. You probably know.
I've probably seen him. Yeah.
I don't think Kyle liked him, but there's quite a long list of wrestlers that Kyle doesn't like for some reason.
Yeah, let's not get into that.
So I think, again, it's all stuff I've put in the written review, so I'm going to plug that. I think that Kaden Garrick's going to be there, and there is going to be a rejected reunion, but it's going to be Archer and Garrick. That'll be the big woo bit in Curl. That'll be the, that'll be the oh no. And then again, this will lead to anarchy. So, like I said, these two matches, I don't know if, again, might not be a clean finish, and that's where we get
the
lead on.
Be paving the way for what's going to come next.
So, but that, six man tags, I think that's the last match before the Rumble.
Okay.
Possibly. So it's Aspen Faith, Blowbar Muhammad, and Caleb Valhalla, your favourite.
Whoop whoop.
Skull, against Brian Tucker, Reese Dawkins, and Zach Dynamite.
I can't stand Brian Tucker. He's just awful. I am not a regular. I'm not a huge wrestling fan. But I want Aspen Faith, Omar Muhammad, and Caleb to win that match. Because of course I do.
Of course. I mean, so do
I'm
I.
Not signed to win.
I feel bad for Omar, because we're sitting in the car, you're wearing a Caleb t-shirt, I'm wearing an Aspen t-shirt. Not really representing Omar.
Yeah, but you know.
You had your hair done, so you're looking sensational.
Ha
ha! Ha ha! You're sick. But no, this is like the tradition before the Rumble, though. It's the big tag team match that'll end up.
Kind of gets you riled up and ready.
They'll batter each other across all over the hall, through the merch stand, all that kind of stuff. So. Yeah. That'll be just a hell of a lot of fun. And
interesting.
The tease of Aspen against Ashwani. I don't know why I get so excited about clothes.
Hope it's pink.
Has to be pink and black, surely.
Yeah.
Has to be. But we'll do a video like after the show and be like, oh, was he? Didn't even have one. He refused it. How dare he? It's going to be. That's just one of those ones. It's just going to be a lot of fun.
Looking forward to that match.
I tried to remember off the top of my head what Dawkins and Tucker's name, team name is. It's I don't know. I can't remember what it is, but it spells out Wally.
What is it? Wally.
which is the most beautiful touch when it comes to this thing, because they're chanting Wally at them, and their team name is Wally.
Yeah.
Yes. That's the subtlety that I enjoy. It's not even subtle. I like that sledgehammering hilarity when it comes to this. That's how I like my wrestling. I'm not here for subtleties. I'll find subtleties, but I'm not here for them. So that's the tag team match. I don't think I'm forgetting any. So the Rumble. That's supposed to pour one. The Rumble. There you go. There's 23 names announced. Well, 22 names announced for the Rumble of 25-man Rumble.
Super Executioner!
Oh, I so hope. Because you still don't believe he's real. So, the 22 names and Mr. WrestleZone, this mystery combatant
it's very Scotty.
Which is definitely not Scotty Swift. Because Scotty has said, although that
it's gonna be Scotty.
Wording is very important because he put in his tweets.
Scotty doesn't know.
Scotty Swift will not be at the Regal Rumble. I will not be the Regal Rumble. Yeah, you're right, because you're gonna be Mr. WrestleZone. That's why, Mr. WrestleZone. If you come out with a red mask on, we all know.
We'll know.
It's gonna be Scotty. I mean, if he comes, imagine if he comes in and it's like.
Because he can't get the red hair dye anymore.
Well, he didn't even speak about that.
Yeah, he spoke about that on the podcast.
One of our many podcasts.
So do you think that's maybe what it is? He's just rebranding.
Maybe.
If I predicted that, I'm going to be so chuffed with myself.
Well, I've got a chat scheduled with him like next Saturday. or next Sunday. So I'll ask if it turns out he is Mr. WrestleZone. Okay. Yeah, we know he is Mr. WrestleZone. But it's going to be like Jeeves that comes out or something. So yeah, Caleb's going to win. That's your prediction. That's my prediction as well. I did a 5 picks, but really I was kind of padding because I didn't want to just go Caleb's winning. So there we go. Right, so let's go to the questions because we do have stuff about it.
Okay.
So I put out any questions you want answered. Asked for faith and replied no.
Thanks.
So
that was pointless.
Touché. Fair enough. I mean, he did answer the question, but yeah. not as I expected. Okay, we've got restockings with how would an octopus lose a rumble match considering the verbiage of both feet must touch the floor when obviously an octopus has more than 2 feet?
It would win the match.
Ah, so Vago will provide the answer for this. Apparently, the octopus have 2 feet and 6 arms.
That's not right.
No, he provided a screenshot.
Oh, did he?
Aye.
Okay, then.
Octopuses don't have 8 arms.
As long as those tentacles hit the floor, then they're out. Yeah. So that's how they would lose.
I would put Dennis in charge of counting which ones are feet and arms, though, because, you know.
They lose count.
They can't count to 3. Dennis. He wasn't at a station hotel. Of course he wasn't at a station hotel.
Of course he wasn't at the station hotel. He'd just become a daddy for the second time. Congratulations, Dennis and Gemma.
I know, I was about to just like go, he was there at the show. I was like, oh, obviously why he wasn't at the show. Which is weird because the young referee, the one that wasn't Mikey.
Yeah.
He's going to be in the Rumble. He's Oliver Green.
Okay.
So I put a pre-show prediction for Abby Anarchy that I want Oliver Green to be against Blue Thunder because I like colours. And I never got Red Lightning versus Blue Thunder.
Oliver Green.
Oliver Green.
Is that a shade? Is he Olive Green?
Oh.
Oliver Green.
In your head here, is he called Olive, middle name R, Green?
Olive or Green.
Oliver Green? If he comes out as a bad guy, that's his chant made for him already. Poor lad, he hasn't even had a proper match yet. We're already making fun of his name. Oliver Green. It's like when Kaylee pointed out that Murphy looks like he goes around going Murphy, 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 Murphy. And that just ruined Murphy for me forever. Because now every time I see him, I just go Murphy, 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 Murphy. Damn it. So Reese, Mickey Vago did answer that question, but I agree. So there you go. They've got 2 feet and 6 arms. You learned something new in this podcast. It's educational. Mainly that I may have undiagnosed ADHD because I got excited when I saw a car that I thought was mine. Ronan King, how screwed is Aspen Faith when I win the Rumble?
Good luck. You've got no chance, dude. I'm sorry. Maybe next year.
You might win against Damien. I don't think you're winning the Rumble. He was one of my 5 picks, but again, I was padding that out. So, how screwed is Aspen Faith when I win the Rumble? I think he's going to be okay, but well, actually, he's not going to be in a great position because he's going to be against Caleb at Anarchy, if all going to our...
And then we will actually have arguments in our house.
We will.
Because...
I like this year that... Like, last year, I had the meltdown of the Rumble. This year, you might have the meltdown of the Rumble.
Well, if Caleb doesn't win, I'm coming to Anarchy.
So if you see the footage back and you see someone in a red Caleb t-shirt walk out or go for a half pint,
I am not Jonathan.
So yeah, we've got inspirational Ryan Riley, always my favourite questions to get because he writes them like
Ryan Riley.
Inspirational Ryan Riley, yes.
It's proven that I remembered his name.
How can you forget Ryan Riley?
I know.
Hi Billy, hope you're well. Are you excited for the Foundation of the Future to become two-time WrestleZone Tag Team Champions? Thanks, Ryan Riley. But as we said earlier, could happen.
Could.
Don't know.
Stranger things have happened.
It's one of those. It's one of those weird ones where you're just like, you could see how the direction would go either way. So if they won, it could be like a big multi-tag match at Anarchy. If they lose, again, it could be a multi-tag match at Anarchy. It could be anything. So. This is that. I think that's got that match has got the biggest question mark of the show.
Yeah.
Because the rest of you can kind of like go, oh, I think this will happen because then it'll set up this. But this one's like, I don't know.
It's a mystery.
It's a mystery. Well, Toya.
No idea.
It's a mystery. Oh, it's a mystery.
Billy.
Okay, I think we're done. Okay, so next bit will be probably the montage, and then if we are still giddy on Prime. We might do a bit after the show, but if it's too dark, it'll probably be myself in my studio.
In your dungeon.
In my dungeon, doing the extra bit at the end and answering extra questions and what have you, doing a bit of review of the show. So, this is the awkward bit where I don't know how to wrap up. See you the next bit. Go say bye.
Bye.
Hi, sorry, I've got bad news for you. I didn't actually take photos at the show or during the show. I got some photos with the guys when I was able to hand them some trophies for the SWN year-end awards, which are available on Instagram, instagram.com/ScottResNet, but there's no photos. Sorry, montage cancelled. What I can give you, though, is this clip that's coming up of, you know what? You know, you're going to have to watch the video. If you listen to audio, you're going to have to watch the video because no words will describe what you're about to see. And then I'll be back with my thoughts about the show and answer some more questions. In the words of the great Chris Kamara, unbelievable. It was a great show. My voice has kind of recovered now. It was Monday now as of recording. Of course, this whole episode will go out on Friday. But it was an absolute blast, as always. I keep banging on every time I do one of these episodes, whether it's W3L or WrestleZone. It's mostly WrestleZone because most of the shows I go to. But God, live wrestling is the best, isn't it? It's just the best. Even after the first throw, is still not great. After the first match in the main show, even Kelly turned to me and went, "I love wrestling. I love live wrestling." And I'm like, "Yes, it is the best thing ever." So that was after the Fair City Saints versus Foundation of the Future. So I don't know if you guys want to take credit for that quote, but it was a phenomenal night. So as far as results go, if you haven't actually seen the results, you should be seeing them on swnscotland.com, and if you haven't, why not? That's where everything is. Results, news, interviews, just that is your hub for Scottish wrestling. But the show itself, I'll just kind of recap some bits and pieces because Adam will no doubt have a review and have some comments, thoughts, and give you a little bit more information on what actually happened at the show, because I'm working on empty. I'm working on just pure energy as well. So it's been, phenomenal. So we got there, Carl Aberdeen, great venue. I really enjoy the venue. It looks like that and Dainston are going to be kind of the two places that WrestleZone are going to be using a bit more often now, along with Station Hotel, which is two of them really nice venues. Station Hotel, I don't like the low ring. That's just my personal preference, though. But as far as getting there, it was phenomenally convenient to get to because it's just across from the train station, the actual, like, the center train station in Aberdeen. So it's some really good venues that they're using now. Not that they haven't used bad venues in the past, but they're
good looking venues, high ceilings, warm, which is nice as well, which is always appreciated. Getting there, it was fine. I went to Dice Farm for some food, which was amazing. They've got a carvery, and oh my god, the plate, they give you a massive plate, and I took full advantage of that. I would not want to turn down an all you can eat, and my physique confirms that. But the show itself, we got there, Pearl Aberdeen, good seats. Of course, we were one row back from Kyla Gailey, because if anyone was going to get landed on, I didn't want it to be me. And we saw the show itself. So Conor Malloy against Murphy. Oh, I set out of actual curl. So last time they had the merch stand in the corner, and this time they moved it into like a room next door. So you had to actually go through a door into another room, and that's where all your merch was. And they had a big WrestleZone backdrop bit, so you get photos. Really great setup. Really enjoyed it. You got more seats in the actual main hall as well, which is always good if you want to get more fans into the actual show. And I really like the merch room bit, and I think they could probably go do more with it. They could probably do some, like, if you come in doing VIP, you could do your meet and greets there quite conveniently. Even if you wanted to do any, like, I don't know, if you do that, they're doing Aberdeen Anarchy at the Easton Community Centre, but if it was at Curl, for example, you could do some like press conference stuff with that backdrop, just with a few folk. If you pay a premium or something like that, it'd be quite cool. Just thoughts out there that you could do, or even if for whatever reason during VIP section, they could play some, I don't know, a full show or something on a TV screen, so you can see some WrestleZone action in the interim, in between matches, or even at the interval, they can just have some old matches on the screen. A TV screen or something, but again, just ideas thrown out there. But show itself, Conor Malloy and Murphy kicked off the VIP pre-show section, the ticket holder match, and I really enjoyed it. I can't remember what I said in my preview. I could probably just check it and then come back in here, but I'm not going to do that because that's too professional. I was thinking it was going to be a good match anyway because of the style mixing. Murphy's been doing really well, and Conor Malloy is phenomenal. And it just really worked out well. The crowd were hot for this match. They were just up for everything that was going on. They were just absolutely hyped to see some wrestling. And they gave the guys so much encouragement and energy that they reciprocated in the match itself. I think if you took away the crowd, the match was probably just really good. But with the crowd, it was great. And Conor Malloy picked up the win with, I think it was a Shining Wizard or Running Knee of some description. And it was really good. Yeah, it was really good. Great kickoff. It's just good to see wrestling. I just enjoy seeing wrestling, and it does sound a bit like, oh, but you saw wrestling back in January, but I'm still excited. 32, and I'm still excited to go see live pro wrestling. I just love it, and I think now that I'm a dad as well, I'm now excited about taking my son to these shows, because I'm always guaranteed a good time, and to hopefully bring him into it. And him to enjoy it as well, it's just going to add an extra level of enjoyment for me, which I don't think is possible because I'm already pretty high on the enjoyment scale. But to add him coming to the shows as well would be ace as a wee Strachan family going to see the wrestling. That's our monthly outing, or an outing every couple months or something. And stay in a hotel, stay in Aberdeen, have some fun, you know? So yeah, great. VIP ticket holder match. I milled around the merch. I think the guys, girls at the merch stand must have thought I was stalking them, because I went through there so often because I wanted to offload some of these trophies. For those that are unaware, I've still got a couple here. I handed these out to the wrestlers that won the year-end awards. Thankfully, most of them were up here. I know that there's a few that I haven't been able to hand out yet. Of course, to Moxie Malone, One to Watch, Iron Girders, and Scotty Toy, and Taylor Bryden as well. That's kind of the ones I haven't actually been able to hand out any physical awards to. But I was milling back and forth. I went downstairs to the cafe as well, and they had Dr. Pepper, which is always good. So it was just a really great experience before the main show even began at Curl. It's a really nice venue. I really appreciate it. It's got a big Tesco next door for those that don't want to. I did notice some folk were like sneaking in their contraband. I was flexing with my wee bottle of Prime, which I ended up leaving at the venue. Just so they know, just so folk know that I got one at Asda, like on Friday. Main show itself. So this was Fair City Saints defending the tag team titles against Foundation of the Future, Ryan Riley and Bruiser Brad Evans. And my God, so Art told you at the end, Kelly turned to me and went, "I love wrestling." And it was after this match because it started off with, of course, Ryan and Brad came out, big bad dudes. And Air Miles flipped into the ring and it was immediately clotheslined by Ryan Riley. And he just spun. And that was him. He was him on the back foot for the whole match. And it was just like that was a big impact to start off the match. And the crowd was like audibly going, "Whoa, whoa," So that happened in the match itself. Was a lot of Alex Webb, of course, fighting back, and the crowd were loving it. They were just all in on Miles and Webb of the Fair City Saints. So it was so effective. The match was so good. There were so many twists and turns. I didn't know who was going to win, as you heard the first part. I was like on the fence to see how it could go. It was either or, and it was very close. I thought the Foundation were going to end up leaving with the titles, but no, Fair City Saints fought back and they got the victory. And it was just it was an amazing opening match, incredible. If I was doing the monthly poll, I tried to pick one match from each show, but I could probably pick multiple matches on the show, which is a testament to the actual event itself. After the match, Ryan Riley said that that no team had beaten them so many times or something like that, and but no team had beaten them twice in one night. So I was thinking, oh, they're gonna wrestle again tonight. But no, we challenged them to a 2 out of 3 falls match at Aberdeen Anarchy for the titles, which was accepted. That little show of respect there, though, I'm gut feeling in my bones, feeling in my gut that by summer, wrestlers are going to love Foundation of the Future. They're going to be big fans. They're going to be cheering the Foundation of the Future. It'll make sense when I'm speaking about more things that happened on the show. But I do have a question coming in about this match. It is from, oh, I'm in my own Instagram. That's embarrassing. There we go. Technology. I am loving it. So I've got Ryan Riley. It was through Instagram, so it's not as polite and formal. Who's more likely to gain 2 falls over their opponent, Foundation of the Future or the Saints? P.S. It won't be the Saints. I think it will be. I don't know. Again, the tag team division is so interesting, especially in WrestleZone, because they've got their core teams. They brought up the Fair City Saints, and they're doing really well, of course, won the titles. And I don't know. That's the thing. That's the best thing about this in general is I don't know, and I like the mystery. I like not knowing what's going to happen when I'm watching the wrestling. I mean, I'll still make predictions. I'll still make like bad predictions or what I'd like to see. But it's the mystery. It's the mystery. So after that, we got Vicky Vago versus Dino. This is kind of weird because it was supposed to be Mickey Vago versus Chris Archer. So that was a match that was supposed to happen. But due to illness, Chris Archer couldn't appear, so Dino replaced him. And I think the match kind of, it was a good match, right? So I'll say that first and foremost. It was a good match. Both guys had a really good showing. But I think it blew the sails a little bit. It blew the wind out of the sails a little bit for some people who may not have seen on Facebook that Chris Archer wasn't going to be there, so they were expecting the showdown between Vago and Archer, and something different. So it would have been like a smaller Archer against the brawling Mickey Vago. Instead, we got two big brawling dudes, and which is great. I enjoyed what I saw, but I think the crowd didn't reciprocate it as much as they would have or could have if it was the original match. But that's outside of anyone's like control. If you're ill, you're ill. I don't want to see someone ill wrestling. That's just silly. But wrestling, I've had a little bit of bad luck at the moment when it comes to that. It seems I can't remember. We have quite a few shows now in the last year or so where someone's been injured or someone's had to couldn't compete or someone couldn't appear, just due to outside circumstances. And sometimes it works. Sometimes we get Connor versus Caleb, at Station Hotel, and it was incredible. It was an amazing match, probably better than we would have got if it was Caleb versus Allen. And sometimes it doesn't always doesn't quite hit possibly the mark. But Mickey Vago Dio, great match, but it just wasn't what we thought was going to happen because it was going to be Archer versus Vega. I don't know, I can't explain it. What I'm saying is it wasn't a bad match. It just wasn't the match that I hoped it would be. There we go. Go with that. After that, we got the. Well, I mean, all this was in the first half because, of course, the second half was all the Regal Rumble itself. So we've got Ronan King against Damien. So Ronan came out as I think what his glasses said. I think it said next champ or something like that. So, of course, they had his mother's coat on as always. And he told Damien, like, after these floods of booze and all that, that Damien couldn't survive 10 minutes with Ronan King, and he was changing the match to a 10-minute challenge, and if Damien lasted 10 minutes, he would win. Yeah, we got there in the end with the stipulation. So a lot of it was really interesting. So it was a normal match. I liked that there was a big timer at the entrance way on their wee Titan Tron, the WrestleZone Tron or the Zone Tron or the Tron Zone. I don't know. So we had that, and when it got to like 2 minutes left, I love that Damien just looked up. I just escaped. I just left the ring, and then it was up to Ronan to get him back. And I loved that. I just loved that little bit of like it took like the wrestler back and forth, and it took them towards took Damien towards the end. Just go, hang on, I don't need to win this. I just need to make sure Ronan doesn't beat me. And it just left. It just started running around the ring and just making Ronan so frustrated about not being able to get Damien and then defeat him. So nice little bit of story, like nice little bit of not even subtlety. It was just a nice bit of story that I appreciated as well, because I love that kind of thing where they don't treat fans like idiots. They're like, look up and go, oh, hang on, guys, I don't need to do this. Why am I still wrestling? There's like a minute left. I just need to make sure I don't lose in that minute. So yeah, it was good fun, but of course it leaves the door open for more stuff to happen, which would be the case later on in the Rumble. I'm going to hopefully remember most of the things that I want to speak about in the Rumble. I will no doubt forget something though, so I apologize. And again, you can check out Adam's review; he'll have more information on all that kind of stuff. Before the Rumble match itself, we had the six man, which was Aspen Faith, Caleb Valhalla, and Omar Muhammad against so defeating Zach Dynamite, Brian Tucker, and Lee Stalkins. And the Warriors against low life entities are, I can't believe it, they are one of the most entertaining things in WrestleZone, and it is ridiculous as to how especially Brian Tucker, who I was disliking like at the start of last year, how he's become one of the more entertaining things in WrestleZone is just beyond me. But I love the start, right? So again, this is another little moment of Rhys Dawkins' brilliance. He's not even, I think he's been a year next month in May. So in May he'll be wrestling on shows for a year. And he always adds these little things, little comments, little bits and pieces that add to his character, as well as just being entertaining. So previously he did things like Brian Tucker said to do poetry in motion, and Reese was like, oh, I love poetry. Of course he does. He's the Shakespeare dude. But this one was great because nobody wanted to face Caleb or Aspen, so there were the trio of baddies were tagging each other in and out, in and out, in and out, and eventually Aspen just told him to stop. And Reese was in the ring at the time, and went, "Do you want to face me?" And Reese went, "No." "Do you want to face Caleb?" "God no." "Do you want to face Omar?" "Yeah, I could take on Omar." It was just the ridiculousness of it, and the crowd automatically got more into supporting Omar because of it. It's so easy to get us fans into a match if you try. If you try and make it entertaining for people to enjoy, they will enjoy it. I don't need major subtleties. I just need give me the story. Don't treat me like an idiot though, but give me the story. I will be there for it, you know? And this one was being like Omar's the smaller of the three, so yeah, we could probably be a batter Omar. This is just, it's always the case when it comes to this particular kind of match in at Regal Rumble is the 6-man or the 8-man or the 10-man, whatever they do that year. Is it was just a bit of a jolly, bit of a carnage, bit of schmoz, schnarrigan, any other word you want, flim flam, a bamboozle, whatever you want to throw in there. But of course, we had like Brian falling off the top rope onto Rhys Dawkins between his legs and a low blow and all that hilarity. But the finish was great as well. It was I can't remember exactly how we got to that point. The referee was distracted. I think Omar had Reese's book possibly, or Tucker was involved somewhere somehow. Regardless of the fact, the referee was distracted. Reese was in the ring, looked up, and both Caleb and Aspen just backhanded him in the nuts, and that was the finish of the match. It was hilarious. It was great. I loved it. just that's it. It was just so much fun, and that was your first half, and that was really yeah, it was just good fun. I love a bit of fun at the wrestling. And that first half was 5 matches, and including the VIP ticket holder, was just fun. Wrestling, that's what wrestling is. It's just good, classic fun. I'm probably going to put up a thoughts thing later on in the week when I think of more things that happened at the show that I want to speak about, or at least want to shout out and enjoy and tell you, oh, I remember this thing happened. You know, but that was the first half of the show. I'm going to breathe now because I think I've spoken constantly for 20 minutes. Regal Rumble then. Regal Rumble was the main event of the show, and oh my God, this was a fantastic Rumble. It was an incredible Rumble. Caleb won. I'll just say that just to start off with. We'll have a clip before we hit up the end credits. I'm going to have a clip of the post show, just a little bit, like, five seconds, something like that, of the post show. But this was just a great Rumble. I mean, previous years, so 2022, I was beside myself. I was fear the whole time because, of course, I wanted Aspen to win. This year, I was a little bit more relaxed. Of course, my main pick was Caleb, so I was hoping he was going to win, and I was on the edge of my seat. But I was watching Kelly just be all in on the Rumble. As soon as Caleb came out, that was it. Laser focused on where he was, what he was doing, who was trying to eliminate him, who he's eliminating. And that's what made it even better. That's what made the match so incredible, was watching her just be invested in it. And it was the best thing because we were quite close, being the second row. I would keep an eye on one part of the ring, and then she would be like pointing out, oh, someone's about to be eliminated here, or Connor's about to be eliminated. Oh no, check out Vago. There was just so much going on, and it just made me more excited to watch it because she was so invested in the match itself. First two were Zach Dynamite and Mickey Vago. So we got a little bit of a rematch from Station Hotel when Dynamite won the title, the Tri Counties title. So there was a little bit of good history there. But as the ring fell up, got fuller. I'm confused. Confused myself now. But as the ring got more packed, there was just so many things happening that you really couldn't take your eyes off of the ring in general. You had to keep looking, you had to keep watching, you could find something, find someone. Of course, Oliver Green made his debut. Did see a whole lot of Oliver Green. He had a little bit of a flurry at the start and then kind of faded into the background a little bit. What I did like is when he got eliminated, he was helped up by Blue Thunder. My colorful team of wrestlers will happen one day. this is as close as I may be able to get it with Oliver Green and Blue Thunder together. I'm hoping they maybe have something at Anarchy. I know Adam's put a predictions thing up, and then I did like 2 minutes later. So I put him as the outfit against Tommy Raiden, Oliver Green, and Blue Thunder. So that's my kind of hopes, you know. A bit of yellow with Tommy Raiden, green, Oliver Green, Blue Thunder, you know. Get me in there. Why did I say the outfit though? That's because little Ted O'Keefe made his return, at Regal Rumble. He came out, Dino and Murphy were in the ring already, and then the old outfit theme played, and out stotted little farmer Ted O'Keefe. Came out looking as disheveled and annoyed as always, as he always did. So he came out. There was a little tease. Oh, is he gonna be against the outfit? But no, there were a trio. That was it. They came out as a team. So why I'm predicting, I think Foundation of the Future are gonna be loved by the summer in WrestleZone. I think it's because that we're gonna get some big beefy boys smacking each other. We're gonna get Bruiser Brad and Dino. We're gonna get Ryan Riley and Murphy. We're gonna get Zack and Dead. We're gonna get that gang warfare in WrestleZone by Battle of the Nations or possibly even Halloween hijinks. That's what I want. So that means it's not gonna happen. So yeah. As far as other surprises, we had Deacon Matthews, of course, Reckless Intent heavyweight champion, make a brief appearance. He said he saw Caleb Valhalla. They shared a hug, and then Caleb threw out Deacon Matthews. No, sorry, threw out Captain Alan Starling. So I think that's possibly another Abby Anarchy match there that they could be easily set up. So Captain Alan and Caleb's story looks to be at least over, or at least paused. Which, to be honest, I think is probably best for everyone because it seemed cursed. The initial Regal Rumble turn and Caleb finally having enough of Alan's shenanigans was amazing, and it seems to be cursed ever since that moment. So I'm glad they kind of put a pause on it, and we might see. I mean, I think Captain Alan against Deacon Matthews would be a good laugh just because of is the cult positivity in Deacon Matthews and the absolute bizarreness, which is Captain Alan Sterling. Put that together, I think you got a good bit of entertainment in there. Other surprises, of course, we had Mr. WrestleZone. I'll get to that in a second. Before I do that, so Ronan King and Damien, of course, they had a little bit of a square off. Well, I say a square off. Ronan ran into the ring and then got eliminated, which I think may have broke the record that Aspen Faith held for a very long time. I don't know. I'd have to get checked. I'd have to have WrestleZone confirm. But I think he may have beaten the record. So Ronan ran back in, and then Damien threw him out again. And eventually, Damien was in the final four. Ronan started picking on Damien's daughter. He was in the aisle way, and it was distracting enough for Damien to be eliminated. So yeah, that's a story that's not finished yet. That's the first chapter logged at Regal Rumble. Maybe the first chapel. Let me suppose the pre-log was the Station Hotel showdown, and now we're trundling along. Whether it's going to be finished, Abri Anarchy, I don't know. Whether this might be the year for Damien and Ronan to go at it before Ronan possibly, hopefully, starts going for gold. Mr. WrestleZone. So before Mr. WrestleZone came out, Rhys Dawkins entered the Regal Rumble to Scottie Swift's music, which everyone was excited by. Until he saw Rhys Dawkins, and then he got booed out of the. He was pelted with boos. He was just the worst person imaginable in that moment, and it was excellent because these like Rhys, like I say, he's been doing this for a year, but he's got it. He's nailed his character. He's nailed all the little subtleties. He knows what to do with the crowd when he needs to do it. He is just yeah. He's excellent. He's fantastic, and it's a credit to the guys at WrestleZone. They've clearly saw what his strengths and weaknesses are, and they're leaning in all in on the strengths, which is he could do the wrestling, but his all confidence demeanor stat and character work is phenomenal. It's great, and they're really putting out some great guys through the training academy just now. So Mr. WrestleZone came out with a mask on. I must have borrowed Scottie Swift boots because they look very familiar, but I recognize that singlet, Jimbo Bannon. I know it's you. I know it's you. So I'm looking forward to see where we go there for Mr. WrestleZone. A nice little moment where they threw Omar out. I think it might have been, it was the foundation threw out Omar, but Mr. WrestleZone caught him and put him back into the ring. And then the old Andrade Almas elimination of Kofi Kingston, I can't remember which rumble it was. Brad was about to throw him back out the same way and then turn around and threw Omar out the other side so he couldn't get caught. So it was a nice cool thing there. A nice cool moment. So what else we've got? So the bit you'll see right at the end of this episode, if you stay tuned, was the death of Mr. Malice, Lord Mr. Malice, part two, three at this point. I don't know. I'm not entirely sure how many times he's died. But Caleb was, the ring was quite full. Caleb was there. out came Lord Mr. Malice, and Caleb went into kind of like Robocop mode. He was like, bitches leave. Everyone left the ring. Malice came in, and you saw the clip just a moment ago. There was a little bit of a tussle. Somehow Lord Mr. Malice did a Canadian destroyer, and looked like that he may be the one to eliminate Caleb again for the second year running. But as he scaled the top rope, Caleb rolled underneath the bottom rope, stood on the apron, grabbed Mr. Malice, and threw him out of the ring. And there was nobody there. There was no one. So recently there's been a lot of discord on wrestling because of a really bad, a really sore looking fall with the Molly Spartan in Rio, where Rio fell off the balcony and hit the apron. There was no, and there was one person there to catch him, catch her, and they missed, they whiffed it. And there's a lot of discourse about it. And I think this was no, if not worse, because there was nobody there to catch Lord Mr. Malice. And it was just the thud again. Why are they making these venues have memories of the death of Lord Mr. Malice? They're like filling them up. So he got thrown out, and when you saw him afterwards, and he had like a bleeding from the back of his head, and there was a video that Kyle Watt put out, and it looked like the Malice hit his back of his head, hit the ring apron as he was getting thrown out. You'll see my clip at the end. It got blocked. You don't actually see the head hit. And it was just disgusting. And how he walked out afterwards on his own volition, like there was nobody, he just walked out bleeding the back of his head. It was disgusting, really. It was really bad. And I think there should have been someone there to, or at least a couple folk there to crash land. But it seems like Lord Mr. Malice is just nuts, because he willingly took the first one when he was thrown out the ring at Regal Rumble 2019. So he was just more than willing to do this one as well. And I think we'll see Lord Mr. Malice at the Rumbles. And they're now terrifying moments to see. So I don't know how to feel about it. It was a spectacle to watch. And the fact that he walked out was even better. I think if he was like helped out, I'd be like, oh no, that was too far. But the fact that he walked out himself, then it makes it better, I suppose. But oh, it was horrid to watch. But outside of that, so saying all that, and so the last four were Damien, Caleb Valhalla, and Bruiser Brad, Ryan Riley. So that was your final four. So in my head, I was thinking, oh, it's going to be Damien, Caleb. That's your final two, because Brad and Ryan have got matches already for Anarchy. And Kelly was turned to me going, no, it's going to be Caleb and Brad. That's your final two. And I was like, yeah, okay, cool. Whatever. And then Damien got eliminated, and it was down to two Foundation members and Caleb. So she was right. That was it. So got to admit when I'm wrong. So we've got a couple questions before I get to the final little bit there. So it's from Callum. Oh, my mic's going a bit weird at my end here. Is Mr. Malice dead? Somehow, no. I don't know how. How did he not die? I don't understand. I don't know how this man is still doing anything. I don't know how he's still about. It's incredible. And another question we've got is from Kirsten Louise, who took amazing photos of the Comic-Con show. If you want to go check out Kirsten L.S. photos, go check that out on Twitter and Instagram, what have you. She did some incredible work, amazing pictures and videos from the Comic-Con. Her question is, did Caleb Valhalla slap the smug look off Ryan Riley's face like he said he would? I can't remember if there was a slap, but he did eliminate Ryan Riley from the match. So I think that's as good as. Oh, thank you, Caleb, for reminding me. Right, okay. So, right. Aspen didn't wear Shivani. And I think that is an absolute disgrace to this. So, yeah, Caleb came out with a Shivani, and Omar came out in a Shivani, and there was no Shivani for Aspen. And everyone we were all a bit disappointed, I'll be honest. We were hoping there's going to be a pink and black Shivani for Aspen. But, you know, we have our trials and tribulations, we move on. So Mike Caleb has asked, do I keep the Shirani and then just put Aberdeen Shirwaniki, which is incredible, and Omar will be stealing that. I'm absolutely certain. Yes, that is my answer. If you're asking me for permission, I will give you it. Keep the Shirani because it looks ace and it makes everything better. So the final two were Bruiser Brad and Caleb, as predicted by my wife. And it was really tense. I don't know how it was tense, because it was like you're watching it going, it's your logical brain going, well, clearly it's going to be Caleb. But in your whatever other brain side of things, we're like, oh, but it might not be. So we're watching this going, oh my God, oh, the tension, the moments, the almosts and what have you. And eventually Caleb dropped down the rope, Bruiser Brad went out the ring, and that was it. Caleb Valhalla, your 2023 Regal Rumble winner. It was just, the crowd went absolutely wild, they went nuts, and it was just a fantastic night, an absolutely incredible show. It was just wonderful. And I mean, that's why people come to these shows. That's why I bang on about these shows. That's why people travel from Glasgow to come see these shows, because they give you a night to remember, they give you a show to remember, and they make you want to come back and see more. So it's just, yeah, it was a fantastic night for Avianaki. The crowd was good, the crowd really good, the crowd really up for the show. I was up for the show, where we got to see a rumble. The only downside of the whole evening was there was roadworks on the way home, and that was a pain in the arse to try and get through. But other than that, but no, it was excellent. It was just a fantastic night. So I think I've answered all the questions that we've got in there. I don't want to keep you guys, if you're listening, still listening, any longer than you have to be, because I think this is probably an hour long episode. I have a little bit of a clip just after the match ended, the Regal Rumble match. Thank you to the guys who accepted their awards, and thanks to like Bruiser Brad, who put up a picture of him with it, with his little award for 1/3 of Tag Team of the Year. Thanks to the guys at Fair City Saints and Damien for letting me take a picture of them with the awards. They were just silly little awards of a rigged bowl, and we had a good laugh about it, and good bit of fun. I've got my ticket for Aberdeen Anarchy 2023 VIP ticket, May 13th at Dainston Community Centre. They will be on sale now. They will go on sale as of recording, 6 o'clock on Monday, but they will be on sale as you're listening to this now. Go get a ticket. If you are going to get a ticket and you're driving to it, look for Dainston Medical Practice. That's the best way to find it on maps. But yeah, get to the show. We've got some matches already announced for Anarchy. They just need to be confirmed before I put them on the site. Once there's a graphic, they go on the site. And it's just, yeah, you're going to love it. You're going to enjoy some wrestling. And, come up to Aberdeen. Aberdeen's a nice place, I think. They have nice food. That's the most important thing for me anyway. And that's it. So thank you for everyone that's been listening or watching the SWN podcast. As always, we are episode 195, I think this one is. Maybe 194. We're on the way to 200. I still have grand plans for episode 200. I don't know if it's going to happen yet. But at the moment, when this episode goes out, we'll be speaking to Scotty Swift on this Sunday. That's the night after the first night of WrestleMania, for an episode in the future. So, good luck, everyone, if you've got 5 hours to spare. We'll try not to make it 5 hours, but you know how these things happen. That's about it. I can't think of anything else, so we'll just wrap up. So thank you very much for joining me today on SWN Podcast. This is a road trip episode with no montage. Shocking. If you want to support us more, go on to swnscotland.com. Got links to everything, Instagram, Facebook, Twitter is where you find me most of the time, at Scott Resnett, and Patreon as well. If you go to Patreon for £1 plus VAT, so I think it's like £1.20, you get access to all these episodes early, like pretty much the day or two after they're recorded. You get the audio version, and the video will go out when it's supposed to go out. But you get the audio version as soon as possible, and I'm hoping to work on some more exclusives for you in the near future. Some archive content that you can listen to, including interviews that have never been released as well. So go check them out. But in the meantime, have a good day, everyone, and just, yeah, go see some wrestling. You know, do it. Do it. Whoa!